Thank you. Good morning to everyone. I look like to thank the organizers and everyone present today. I will briefly show how the American electrical engineer Vannevar Bush tried to unify science through a mathematical technology, the differential analyzer. In fact, this first analog computer allowed dialogue among different branches of knowledge and encouraged international cooperation. Independent research, like studies on aurora borealis and the cosmic rays, found a point of union in the use of machine. So Bush increased value of basic research in universities. My history starts in 1902, when the Norwegian scientist Christian Birkeland made two expeditions to the polar regions to record material which would explain the origin of the Northern Lights. Birkeland's view was that the aurora were due to the corpuscular rays emitted by the sun. His experimental investigations conducted with a small magnetic derailleur confirmed the movement of electric corpuscles from the sun to the earth, but not explained their origin. The Norwegian mathematician Carl Stormer was fascinated by the large amount of data collected by Birkeland and faced the problem of point of view of mathematics. The result showed that cathode rays were affected by the Earth's magnetic field. He modelized the path taken by charged particles using a nonlinear system of differential equations and polar coordinates. But the equations of motion had not analytical solutions. They were necessary 30,000 hours to solve them with a mechanical hand calculator. In the same years, the Nobel laureate Robert Millikan began the study of the mysterious ambient radiation just discovered by the Austrian Victor Hess and the Italian Domenico Pacini. Millikan's research confirmed that these mysterious rays were coming from outer space, but its source remained a puzzle. He dubbed them cosmic rays and declared they were photons. Millikan proposed a vision of a universe continually creating and recreating itself throughout eternity. But this hypothesis did not find everyone's favor. In 1932, in opposition to the Millikan thesis, Arthur Compton concluded that cosmic rays were principally charged particles. Compton and his collaborators measured the geomagnetic effects brought about by change in latitude and longitude and the variation of the intensity of cosmic rays with height. The question now concerned the nature of their charge. Was it positive or negative? Could cosmic radiation deliver information to scientists about the origin of the cosmos? According to the Belgian cosmologist and Catholic priest Georges Lemaître, cosmic rays could be part of the extremities left over when our solar system was created. His theory was that a certain amount of matter and energy did not condense with the stars and planets and was left at a speed in space. Matter is occasionally visible in comets and meteors and ignited to Earth's upper atmosphere. Lemaître moved on to the US at the Harvard College Observatory in 1924. He studied for a PhD in physics at MIT with the physicist Manuel Vallarta, and with an impeccable mathematical technique, prepared the model of the universe in which the radius grew as a function of time. The idea of an expanding universe was born in Lemaître. Lemaître believed The atomic nuclei were produced by disintegrations of primeval quantum. In 1941, Lemaître explicated his primeval atom hypothesis and or fireworks hypothesis in a letter to Nature. Starting from this intuition, he conjectured that some high energy particles produced during this early disintegration could be detected. Millikan invited Lemaître to the California Institute of Technology in Pasadena to talk about the idea of cosmic rays, like a sort of a fossil radiation that could tell us something about the first moments of the universe. Fritz Zwicky from the Pasadena Institute pointed out that the astronomical effects of the cosmic rays are still an unexplored theme. He and his colleague Walter Budd started the observations with the Smith telescopes and in 1934 coined the term supernova. What discovered lie ahead? Back to MIT, Lemaître began to work on cosmic rays with his teacher, the Mexican physicist Sandoval Vallarta, to have confirmations for its cosmology thesis. Vallarta taught electromagnetic theory at the new MIT's communication option curriculum. They started an experiment aimed to draw the cosmic ray trajectories. They used the notation of the system used by Stormer for the aurora, but the equations did not have analytical solutions. So Vallarta asked his teacher and colleague, Vannevar Bush, for advice. Bush was dean of the electrical engineering department and famous inventor of the first analog computer functioning, the differential analyzer. Vallarta was one of the graduates of Bush and had worked with him on a book published in 1929 on the Eve side operation of calculus. Bush suggested to use his analyzer to find the numeric solutions of the equations. The proposal was innovative because it combined Lemaître's theoretical approach with MIT's own applicative approach to the technology. With his collaborators, Bush had completed the differential analyzer in 1931 after receiving the Levy Golden Medal for invention of an integraph. Analyzer was an electromechanical computer for solution of differential equations. It was able to draw graphically their solution as curves or graphs. There were six mechanical integrator units and series of input and output tables. A torque provided the coupling between the wheel of the integrator and the mechanical shafts of the rest of the analyzer. Using the different shafts to connect the input and the output of the different functional components together, it was possible to build a system whose behavior was governed by a differential equation. Bush did not patent the analyzer and put the computing power of the machine available to other scholars because he hoped for the contribution of any user to improve the machine. Solving the Lemaître-Vallarta system of equations was a collaboration and a challenge for the analyzer and Bush team. After a dozen tentative diagrams on paper, the original analyzer was modified by Samuel Caldwell, who found an ingenious method to set the problem through a series of machine connections, as the figure shows. In fact, the final accuracy of a curve drawn by the analyzer depended on the reliability of the machine and principally on the accuracy of the laborious and often complicated numerical calculations required to introduce the initial conditions in each of the components of a system. It also depended on the attention and accuracy with which the five assistants kept under control the known functions traced on metal plates in the input tables. First, Lemaître and Vallarta calculated the shape of cosmic ray trajectories in the Earth's magnetic field. Second, they want to find the allowed directions between those outside the Stormer cone. They used Carl Stormer formalism, developed for calculations on the Norton Light orbits in 1920. Unlike Stormer, they also applied the Liouville theorem, like Enrico Fermi and Bruno Rossi had done to the present problem. So they got more accurate results than Stormer. One of the most important predictions of the two scientists' calculation was the Oesthesite asymmetry effect. Due to its complexity, the work was first attempted in the winter of 1932 and then carried out in two stages. The first test in December 1933 gave valid information on the general appearance and the properties of a series of asymptotic trajectories for values in the figure. It provided good prospects for the use of harmonic expansions. The disadvantages were that the trajectory started from a region of instability subjected to small errors due to the machine or the initial data. The second test in the spring of 1935 solved the previous problem with a different approach, starting the trajectory's advance from a suitable chosen point on the equator and then adjusting the initial slope in such a way that the trajectories did not intersect and did not fall close to periodic orbit, which was already known. After several tests, about 25 trajectories were calculated with a good approximation to minimize the error. Vallarta and Lemaître showed that cosmic rays can only be charged particles, like Compton's hypothesis, ruling out the possibilities that they were just gamma rays. Bush offered all of the resources of his department for Lemaître and Vallarta's work, so he suffered the resentment of some of his colleagues. But the analyzer limitation did not allow to set the three-body problem. In fact, it was not analytically integrable and generated divergences in the equations when the bodies approached each other, when the Newtonian force tended to infinity. Only in the late 1950s, Lemaître discovered a transformation in variables that could eliminate the divergences. But at the time, the Lemaître's legacy passed to André Depree at Leuven University. So Bush planned another analysis, one more precise in its calculation and with a large universe of mathematical possibilities. The opportunity to pursue his plan presented itself in the person of Warren Weaver, who in autumn of 1931 had become the director of the Natural Division of the Rockefeller Foundation. Weaver had first heard of the analyzer at a meeting in Paris with the Norwegian astrophysicist Svein Rosaland, a Rockefeller Fellow at the Mount Wilson Observatory in Pasadena and visiting professor at Harvard College Observatory. Making plans for his new Institute of Theoretical Physics at the University of Oslo, Rosaland was interested in acquiring an analyzer with Rockefeller money to facilitate astrophysical calculations. Weaver visited Bush in November to see the analyzer, and he was very much impressed. Bush presented to the Rockefeller Foundation a new project for an electronic analyzer. To increase the speed of the machine, Bush suggested to introduce a servo mechanism that allowed instantaneous change from one problem to another without a human intervention. The Depression discouraged the Foundation from responding to Bush's overtures until the spring of 1935, when it awarded MIT a preliminary grant of $10,000 to complete the study of the improved analyzer. Back in Oslo, Rosalind started the project of analyzer. As Bush had opened, Rosalind introduced more efficient solutions than Boston's analyzer. Mainly, he designed a simpler system for setup input conditions to save time. Equipped with 12 integrator units, the Oslo analyzer was completed in 1938 and covered over 20 square meters in a room. It was the world's largest analyzer. The machine was accountable and reliable. Bush provided Rosalind some pictures of the machine apparatus that Rosalind used for building his Oslo analyzers and then spread to other European universities. Many Bush's analyzers were built all over the world, from Manchester to Australia and even Leningrad. In 1936, at the Oslo Congress of Mathematicians, Stormer was proud that the University of Oslo would be the home of the world's most powerful computer. He showed his new results on different forms of aurora and talked about new discoveries regarding cosmic rays, which had revealed Stormer's method had broader fields of application. His hope was that mechanical integration of differential equations became more important not only in the applications, but also in pure mathematics. In 1940, when Germany occupied Norway, Rosalind removed the integrator wheels from the machine and buried them safely to make sure that his differential analyzer would not support Germany's war efforts. In 1946, back from America, he tried to reassemble the analyzer, but above all, he updated it with a new solution. But toward the end of 1947, there was a decrease in scientific demand for the analyzer. This revealed the limit reached by the machine with respect to now technologies. Now, scientific research requires different performances of computation that the new electronic and digital computers could offer. In Leuven, Lemaître established a school of scholars interested in cosmic ray research. After the war, he purchased the first digital computer for the University of Leuven, the Borough E101, and learned to program it. Lemaître published the mathematical analysis of the three-body problem in 1963. He died in 1966, but in July 1965, his theoretical interpretation in terms of Big Bang received confirmation. Also, Vallarta established a research team interested in cosmic ray research in his homeland. Vallarta and his Mexican colleagues published a series of papers on the application of cosmic ray theory to the magnetic momentum of the Sun and galactic rotation. From 1954 to 1958, research conducted by the Mexican University was focused on the albedo effect of cosmic rays. Cosmic ray research was cultivated in Universidad Nacional Autónoma de Mexico and has taken on new vigor during the last year. Conclusions. In 1938, Bush left MIT and he left the Rockefeller Project. He was appointed president of the Carnegie Institution in Washington and began his collaboration as a scientific advisor of the President Roosevelt. After the war, all the analyzers were disassembled, but computation has become the methodology that working on the border between disciplines has changed the way of reasoning and setting problems in physics as in other disciplines. In 1945, Bush published Science: The Endless Frontier, a pivotal report that marked the beginning of modern science policy. Bush's report popularized the phrase basic research. Furthermore, it promoted international collaborations for sharing scientific knowledge. In fact, some protagonists of this story, like Vallarta, had the role of ambassadors of science in international public institutions in support of the value of their nations and the reconstruction of Europe starting from science. But this is the beginning of another story. Which region?
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Benedetta, for the, highlighting this the relevant aspect of a computational science in the development of cosmic ray physics. And so there is a question by Lucia De Frenza. She asks, what did Bush mean by basic research?
Okay, thank you. I thank for your question is very interesting. Thank you, Lucia. Bush was appointing a president of the Carnegie Institution in Washington and began his collaboration as a scientific advisor of the President Roosevelt and career of politician of science. Bush broadened the meaning of the phrase basic research in using it to refer simultaneously to demand of policymakers for practical innovation and to interests of scientists in curiosity-driven inquiry. He satisfied both sectors. Bush basic research descriptor helped to secure a pragmatic compromise between scientists and politicians. Okay.
Thank you. Thank you, Benedetta. I don't see other questions here. So if...
I had a comment, if I might. Okay. I'm sorry, yeah. I don't understand how to use the chat thing. But I really enjoyed the talk, but I wanted to make a comment about Lemaître and Vallarta and how their paper was seen by Stürmer. Stürmer was incredibly critical of it. He pointed out that they didn't really understand Liouville's theorem and they didn't even get the direction of the Earth's magnetic field correct. And I make this comment because, in fact, Bruno Rossi had been able to interpret Stürmer's very difficult calculations in a very elegant way and predict that it was useful to look for the east-west effect to establish the charge of cosmic rays. And Rossi is very often, his work is very often overlooked by comparison with the work of Lemaître and Vallarta, which, as I say, was strongly criticized by Stürmer. There's a paper by Stürmer as it is in PhysRev.
Okay, thank you. Biographies of Stürmer do not say of how much actual use the machine was in his calculations. In any case, Stürmer was personally located at the Astrophysics Institute in Blinder, where the machine would also place it. Stürmer admitted the error and continue the research. I don't know. Thank you.
I see here, thank you, Benedict. I see here another question by Scott Walter. He asks, were the results of Lemaître-Bush collaboration empirically relevant?
Lemaître's studies affected the research in Pasadena, probably. Here, Walter Baden and Fritz Zwicky pioneered the use of the first Smith telescopes placed in a mountaintop observatory, and in 1934, coined the term supernova. They hypothesized the supernova where the transition of normal stars into neutron stars and as well as the origin of cosmic rays. This was an opinion which contributed to determining the size and the age of the universe subsequently. But Zwicky stated that we therefore feel justified in advancing tentatively the hypothesis that cosmic rays are produced in supernova process. But the story of the research on the origin continues. Thank you.
Thank you, Benedetta. You have all the answers well prepared.